Welcome to Chicago Medical Review. I'm your host, Frank, and we're starting our fourth season. So today we're going to do something a little different. Over the last several years, we've been talking to doctors and nurses within the hospital system within the suburbs here in Chicago. So last year, my director came up with an idea because he is one of the faculty members at Northern Illinois University in their MBA program. So he came up with three programs of new medical innovations, and he wanted to know what I thought of them and if they should be on the show. So I looked them over, and I thought they were three great ideas. So for the next several weeks, instead of dealing with problems that doctors cause, we're going to find ways to fix the problems that doctors are causing in the medical field. So our first show that we're going to talk about is something that's close to me, and that's Alzheimer's and dementia. Now, I'm going to give you a little facts first. 5.5 million Americans suffer from Alzheimer's on the age group of 65 and over. Worldwide, that's over 47.5 million people with the disease. And if you think it's only for older people, over 200,000 Americans under the age of 65 also suffer from Alzheimer's. And two-thirds of Alzheimer patients are females. So this is an important topic. And one of the major problems with Alzheimer's is a syndrome called wandering. And in the early stages of the disease, while the person's still not totally with it, as we should say, they start wandering and they actually get lost. And you always hear it on the news at least once a week, there's a yellow alert for a person who's wandered out of their home. Or in my case, I left my mom with my brother for an afternoon and he left her in the car and he had the 7-year-old look at her and say, make sure grandma doesn't leave the car. Well, guess what? Grandma wandered off. And so when he got back to the car, he found out that grandma wasn't there. And so he asked the 7-year-old, where is she? And she goes, oh, she just left. So the first case is, or the first business thing that we're going to talk about is a wonderful company called CareBand, and I've got their founder and CEO, Adam Sobol. Welcome to the show.
Thanks so much for having me.
And tell me, what got you into this?
So I come from a family of doctors. Everybody in my family is a doctor except for me. I'm kind of the odd technology guy out of the mix. So about 4 years ago, Apple came out with this new technology called iBeacon technology. And it was kind of released secretly that Apple released, and I was a nerd and I thought it was super cool, so I learned everything I could about this technology. And what I learned was that it was a new technology that enabled devices to communicate with each other in close proximity and low power. So it enabled a whole bunch of new applications. So I was telling my dad about this, and he's a geriatrician, manages about 10,000 seniors in Ohio. And I explained to him simply what the technology did, and he said, you know, what if you could use this same technology to help people living with dementia who wander and get lost. At the time, I didn't really have a direct connection to this dementia, wandering, Alzheimer's thing, but I quickly learned that everyone else that I talked to could relate to it. So I heard stories from people who told me about their grandmother, who, similar to you, had taken their grandmother out to lunch, and they went to the bathroom and came back, and their grandmother wasn't there anymore. Or somebody who went to bed with their spouse and then woke up in the middle of the night to find out that their spouse wasn't there. Over and over again, this emotional story just poured out of people. So I knew that there was a problem here and the current technology really wasn't solving it. The other thing that I learned was that the current technology was 30 plus years old. It was big, beige, and ugly, very institutional, and it didn't really work. It kind of band-aided the problem, but didn't really solve it or really help anyone. So I figured there's a huge amount of people that needed this kind of a product, and the technology doesn't work very well that exists today, and we should try working on it. So I started the company then.
So that it's a great idea because in the medical field, we've had people with dementia, schizophrenia, Alzheimer's, all these other mental health issues, and we used to put them on a separate ward, and we would lock the doors, or the doors came with a special lock where their bracelet would activate it so they couldn't leave the facility. But the problem is you were worried about space, and you had a space limitation. So that meant all your patients were on one floor, those with mild dementia all the way to those with severe dementia. And I think we've all been to a hospital where you hear the person screaming from their room, help me, and they just don't stop. And then you got the patient that is just in the mild stage, And so they're confused, and now they hear this, and then they get scared. So a product is needed where you can get them out of the institutions and back home. Now, 12 years ago or 10 years ago, I used to use the Tile. It just came out, and actually I bought it for my dog. I thought it would work on the dog. Found out it only had a limit of 30 feet or 30 yards. So with that, if the dog wasn't next door, that didn't help. And I remember one day my mom wandered off, and I didn't even know she wandered off until the police came. And then my next door neighbor says, the police have your mother. So I went outside and went to the front of the house because I had a huge party in the back of the house. And I stopped the officer and I explained it. The minute he heard the whole story, he's like, take your mom. She wandered into one of the other neighbor's house and started watching TV. And no clue of where she was. So the Tile really didn't work. So we needed something that was a little bit better. And now it seems you got a product that, what's the distance now on your product?
So one of the challenges that we saw on the market was that the technology was all either GPS and cellular-based technology, or it used Wi-Fi and maybe it used Bluetooth, but nothing really worked indoors and outdoors. The other challenge that we had with building this technology was people with dementia don't often carry their smartphones around with them. So you can't really use that like you would with your Fitbit or your Apple Watch because they don't have it with them all the time. And then Wi-Fi, there's not often Wi-Fi or reliable Wi-Fi in people's homes or in these nursing homes, so we couldn't use that technology either. So we found this new Internet of Things communication technology called LoRa. It's a low-power, wide-area network communication technology that enables us to send data in low power, and sends data in small amounts of data over really long distances. So we can send data up to 3 miles in a city environment and then up to 5 miles in a rural environment, just by using our gateway and our system.
Now, do the towns and cities have to be built up for this? Do they have to increase their infrastructure for this?
So the nice part is that we have an end-to-end kind of out-of-the-box system. So if the city doesn't have this infrastructure already in place, we can come and set it up and we can give you that 3 mile radius. The other exciting part is that we're actually partnered with Comcast. They have a new Internet of Things communication network called Machine Q. And we're actually partnered with them. And in certain cities, they already have this infrastructure set up. So places like in Philadelphia and in San Francisco, some in Chicago as well in certain areas. So anywhere in those areas where it's covered, you actually have coverage.
And luckily, Comcast has a huge coverage area. And I noticed that because when we were talking about Wi-Fi, everybody's home is different. Like mine is AT&T, while my neighbors are Comcast, or someone else is RCN, WOW, or one of the others. So they don't work on each system. So now, so what you end up doing now, that you partnered, I know, with Northern University of Illinois. And what made you do that?
So we've been really focused on selling into assisted living facilities and nursing homes. But what we would really like to be able to do is to help people living at home. One of the significant challenges with people caring for someone with dementia is this wandering behavior. And typically when somebody exhibits wandering, it pushes them from, yes, I can take care of my mom at home, to no, I really can't. And you either have to hire 24/7 care or put them in a facility. And what we believe is that our technology can help people stay at least 6 months longer in their home. The challenge for us was that we didn't have kind of the business plan written or really didn't understand how the operations of it would all work, since our model was really focused on senior living. So working with NIU, we were able to gain a team of experts in business who were learning in their MBA to put together this plan and a roadmap so that we could follow it and help as many people as possible.
So this actually made it a little bit easier for you to spend most of your time working on your product and working to make it better and let them come up with the other plans.
Exactly.
So, welcome back to Chicago Medical Review. I am privileged to have the director of the executive MBA program at NIU, and assistant dean, Ann Carroll.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you.
As you know, for the last three shows that we're doing, we had all their executive MBA graduates who are with the Mather program. How did you hook up with the Mather program?
Yeah, that's a great question, Frank. Thanks. We actually have been doing these consulting projects for a number of years, and we really are always looking for companies to work with in the Chicago market. And through our dean, he had some relationships with the individuals that matter, and we presented the option and the idea of doing some consulting for them. And through that, we were able to get these three projects that you've been talking about for the last few weeks.
And these are three excellent projects.
Excellent projects.
So this is your first year with them, right?
It is, and we hope it's the beginning of many long, more years long of a relationship. Long relationship.
Well, all your students were excellent. They all showed some great, they answered all the tough questions too, so they did a great
goodness.
Job. They did a great job. But I do want to thank you for coming. I want to first thank you for letting these people come onto the show and explain these three great things into the medical healthcare field. So thanks for coming on, and I hope we can get you again with more of your students next year.
Fantastic. We look forward to it.
From Chicago Medical, we're going back to our next person that we're interviewing. Our teacher is Ed Buckley, who's my director for this show. So he's the one that got you to come on. So I want you to introduce yourself and then tell me what your aspect on this project was.
Thank you, Frank. My name is Nag Jaiswal. I'm with the Executive MBA program at NIU. Also, you know, we are full-time employees of professional companies. So I work for Salesforce. And I'm in advisory services, you know, work for as an advisory service there. With this program, I'm providing marketing and finance aspects of the business plan, rolling my experience as well as what we have learned in the program for the last 18 months is culminating in that. So whether it is pricing or whether it is market segmentation or you know, what are the aspects of cash flow? All those are being rolled into the business plan.
So your job is to find the people that are going to be financing this program?
It is.
Or come up with the plan for how to finance it.
It is nuts and bolts. So basically how to raise the equity, what budget, you know, what debt is required, what's the cash flow looking like, where do we sell, how many pieces do we sell every month. Reach all the numbers that make this successful. So putting all of that together.
And now your job and aspects, introduce yourself.
My name is Steve Newton. I'm actually looking at the sales strategy part of this business. My background is actually in healthcare and retail sales. Okay. So when we take this population that we are trying to solution this issue with, I'm taking Nog's strategy of the finances and actually looking at the sales strategy, both pre and post sale. So it's been very enlightening to discover this community of people that need a solution.
Now, is it your job also to figure out what the sales forecast is going to be in the 5 and 10 year part?
Yeah.
And for this product, what do you see of the sales force?
Well, you think about the population that you said, 5.5 million, right? So that's a captive audience that you have. But, you know, we specifically worked with some partners to actually look at who's actually interested in this wandering thing. I don't know if we're able to share those numbers here, but we're looking at targeting a very conservative amount of 1% of that population.
And that's actually a low conservative value, because I look at it and going, I see it at 10% or more, because when you see the amount of people that are actually suffering from this disease, and the number that I gave you is based on 2015.
Correct.
They're predicting by the year 2030, it's going to double and triple.
Correct.
And as the baby boomers are still getting older, and they go all the way up to 2050 before they stop, and then you start with the millennials and everyone else. And at the same token, younger people are suffering from this disease also. So it's that 1% is pretty low for you. So it actually your numbers can actually increase even more. Mm-hmm. So now your part of this.
So to add to that, we think Illinois is in the top 10 for the states that are going to see the largest increase additionally. So it's an exciting opportunity. So Tom Cleland, I'm with the Ecolab. I'm a senior operations manager. My part in the project is to bring an operational aspect as well as my old previous sales, some sales perspectives to the project also.
because now your part, I know that in this program you have a 10-step thing that you have to try and solve.
Right.
You have management plans, marketing plans, operation plans, and then you have the course return of investments for, because the people are going to be putting in capital, of course, they want to make their money too. Mm-hmm. So all these things you have to work with. Now, how long have you been with this, working with this one product?
This is almost 8 months now.
So 8 months.
Yeah.
And how much longer do you see until you come up with, have you come up with a plan already?
Yes. So we are actually wrapping up with that plan. It's about 95% complete. And what we are going to do is present this Friday, that is tomorrow. And then once that's done, it is more of refining what we have done and canning it so that it's more consumable at the executive level.
So now this was your final project for all three of you for your MBA, right?
Correct.
Yes.
And most MBAs are a 2-year program, right? Is this the same thing or is it longer or shorter?
It's 18 months.
18 months, okay.
Yeah.
Because I know they have programs that are out there for people that are working full time.
Yes.
So
we're working full time along with
that's
this.
Us.
Don't worry, I know exactly what that's like. I went through it. Have they fulfilled what you're looking for?
So I'm excited to see the final presentation. I think so far we've seen the marketing plan, we've seen kind of the executive summary and kind of where their head is. One of the really exciting parts of bringing their perspective into this is that they come from all these unique backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And I, as a company, it's me and then my board of directors and a few people on my team, but they have all this unique experience that I don't have. So seeing their experiences through their work has been super interesting to see what they've come up with during the process.
Now, your background is not medical, so it's more computers and stuff, right? So did you get an IT degree or something?
Yes, so I studied informatics at Indiana University, and then I got my master's in cybersecurity and information systems at Indiana.
And that's a growing profession. you could have kept very happy just in that one profession.
That is true. I was at a point where I had finished the master's program, and I was still working on CareBand. And I worked for a year doing cybersecurity consulting, and it was a hot field.
Mm-hmm.
But I got to the point where I was doing CareBand on the side and doing this consulting, and it was just competing for my time. So now, it was a challenge.
How much of this did you design, or did you have to use somebody else to do the actual computer breakdown and all that and actually come up with the model of what it's supposed to look like?
Yes, so my background really is on the software engineering side and the designing the security around the entire system and the data infrastructure and that piece of it. We're working with a team of engineers that are all ex-Motorola engineers in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Who have been able to help us take it from kind of concept and idea all the way to where we are manufacturing it.
Let's see, can you pull out one of the products, see how big this is really going to be?
Yes.
So did you have to come up with the actual design, or did someone else come up with the design for you?
Yeah, so our team of engineers helped us all the way through. So basically, I took them this big breadboard prototype is what it's called. And it was like almost as big as this table of what the CareBand actually was.
Mm-hmm.
And it proved out that the CareBand actually worked. This idea in my head actually did the function that I was trying to make it do. And then the bringing on these engineers helped me to refine it and get it down to something that was wearable.
How heavy is this product? Oh, it's very lightweight. Now, is there a way to lock this so that the person can't take it off them?
So, great question. One of the challenges is to have the device on the person all the time.
Right.
So we did make it waterproof so you can wear it in the shower. In terms of locking, we actually invented, and I didn't bring one with me, but we invented a two-handed lock. So it fits on any watch clasp that you have today. And you squeeze in two sides and then you twist the top and you can take it on and off. But even I can't do it on my own. It takes two hands. So you got to have somebody else with you to
which
help.
Works because if you ever dealt with dementia patients, that's all they do is fidget, fidget, and fidget. And they will keep playing with something. So
yes.
Luckily that it has a built-in feature like that. And it's so lightweight, I'm just surprised. Now let's get down to the real thing now. Cost-wise, is it going to be affordable for, I mean, will it, and Medicare hasn't approved it yet, have they?
So it's not an FDA device,
okay.
So we don't actually go through Medicaid, but the The goal was to help as many people as possible with this device. So making it as affordable as possible is really part of that. So we're still working on the exact pricing. It's probably going to be around $200 for the unit.
Which is way affordable.
Compared to hiring a caregiver 24/7 or putting somebody in a facility.
See, I was waiting for you to say maybe $400 or $500, but you're actually way in the affordable range at $200. Even if you go a little bit above that, it's still considered. Considering, I know Apple now has for their phone, you can now do EKGs. And for $95, you can hook a little thing onto your phone and send all that data to the primary care doctor so that they can see your actual EKG, so they would know if there's a problem. So everything is, it seems everything in electronics keeps coming down in price. So this is a very affordable product.
Yeah, the other benefit of the product too is all that data that we're collecting. So we're collecting data on location, activity, behavior, and environment to understand early changes in condition. So the concept is if we can understand how many times someone's going to the bathroom or how much sleep they're getting, we can look at those changes and say that somebody's going to get a urinary tract infection or pneumonia or is more agitated at this time in the morning or stuff like that to understand.
So all that, it keeps data on all that.
Yeah, so the data that we're collecting from the device gets streamed up to our infrastructure, and then we have some data scientists on our team who are looking at the data to look for patterns, to look for different changes in those patterns.
So this actually does more than just prevent wandering. The fact that you said that it looks at UTIs, which one of the number one complications with people with dementia, Alzheimer's, is urinary tract infections. And then and one of the companies that's going to be coming onto the show is going to be talking about 30-day and 7-day returns to hospitals to try and prevent those, because Medicare is not going to be paying for that anymore. And most insurances are actually cutting, and the hospitals are actually losing money if a patient comes back. So this will keep track of their walking, breathing, and everything else.
Yes, so the goal is to keep people out of the hospital, especially for people with dementia. Whenever you change their environment, it leads to a much quicker decline. So if we could keep them constantly either in their home or in assisted living or wherever they're most comfortable and alert a care provider 3 days before there's a fever or some other symptom, then we can give them medication or give them therapy before they have to go to the hospital and go through all that.
So actually, they're under that 10-plan system, were they able to meet most of your goals at Northern University, Northern Illinois?
Yeah, so they've been outstanding to work with. I'm excited to actually implement their plan that they've been working on and turn it into a real thing. I think that's the next step.
Now, where have you been testing it? What areas?
So we've been testing in a nursing home down in Niles, Illinois.
Okay.
It's a nursing home that has rehab, nursing, and memory care. We've been testing their memory care population, and it's been going very well so far. We started a pilot back in June of last year. And now they've been working on or been using the product for about 6 months now. And we've been able to find people when they've gotten lost, which is
exactly what you want.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, have you been able to meet these areas, like go down to Niles, Illinois, and actually see these patients and test your products down there?
No, we were not.
So you're just working on the other aspect away from.
Yes, and also we have within our family and friends who have dementia, so we know what the patient goes through, but mostly we are going through the market research and the studies that we have received.
Now, all three of you have a medical sales background, right?
Just sales. Correct.
Which opens up a lot of doors in the sense that you see what hospitals need and what other people need also.
Yeah, sure does. Yeah. Yeah, the skill sets are definitely transferable, and it's helped us with the project and to think about the best way to get the product to the market, to the mass, as fast as possible, and to bring in the necessary cash flow to keep the business going forward.
So it seems that this program actually did what you wanted it to do.
Absolutely.
To teach you what you actually
without
needed.
Without a doubt. Yeah,
without a doubt, yeah.
It's been great working with Adam and the product, and it's been wonderful, great experience.
Great. Well, as usual with most of my shows, we're always running out of time. What we are going to do is show a small clip of close-up of this product that I was able to download from your site so that people can actually see it close-up of what it's going to do. So I want to thank you for coming on the show. I want to thank you guys for actually taking time to come up here and come on the show, especially on a Thursday night.
Thank you for having us.
From Chicago Medical Review, I'm Frank, and I'll see you next month.